Alexa. Hello, welcome to our brand new series of favourite game show. It's an exciting year for video games with loads of new ideas and lots of funky new hardware. Later in the programme, I'll be checking out the newest consoles.
And I'll be strutting my funky stuff with this virtual guitar with the special help of our guest star this week, Craig McLachlan!
Much later on. Our main review this week is Panzer Dragoon on the Saturn.
And I'll be chatting to some of the shiniest, happiest people in Los Angeles as I unearth the secrets behind one of this year's biggest games, Earthworm Jim 2.
But first, 1995 is going to be the most exciting year yet for video games. All the big names have brought out new, chunky hardware. This was the first hit of the shops in this country, the Sega Saturn. It's been out since the 8th of July, and as well as Panzer Dragoon, there are several other games already available. In most high street shops, the Saturn comes packaged with Virtua Fighter. But the Saturn manufacturers weren't happy with the game, so they've now put out a cleaned-up version. It's called Virtua Fighter Remix, and it features much better graphics and more polished gameplay. In America, if you brought a Saturn, they'll send you the remix free, but in this country, it'll cost you about £30. Other games to come include Sega Rally, the newest arcade racing game. These world-exclusive shots are from the actual Saturn version of the game.
The next super console to be released in the UK is this one. This is the Sony PlayStation, and it's out this month. All the software comes on these funky black CDs, and the machine itself is really small and neat. It features these weird-shaped joypads with four control buttons on the top. Once again, you can expect to see a lot of arcade favourites like Ridge Racer, the incredibly fast urban racing game.
Round one.
And Tekken, one of the best-looking 3D beat-em-ups ever. One thing to watch, though, now the games do come on CD, is you can't save your position. The PlayStation only has a tiny bit of memory reserved for saving positions, maybe one or two. So actually, what you need is one of these memory cards, and that plugs in this hole above the joypad port.
The subject displayed.
Some more familiar hardware is getting a special boost with some special extra kit. There are big plans for the Jaguar this year with a brand spanking new add-on for the machine, a CD drive. You can expect to see games like this one, The Ruinous Forces, a Space Marine Corps shoot-em-up. There's some great full-motion video, and it's one to watch out for.
But what about the other Japanese games giant, Nintendo? Well, there's still no official word about their super console, the Ultra 64, although we have managed to track down this rather chatty photograph of it. The Ultra 64 coin-op game Killer Instinct was scheduled to be the first game released with the home machine, but because of the delay, that's been cancelled and replaced by, you'll never guess, yes, Killer Instinct 2. More news about this in November when the Ultra 64 is finally unveiled to a waiting world at a Japanese computer trade show.
On the other hand, the 3DO is still alive and kicking and now has a stable full of really top software. In the last few months, killer titles like Return Fire, the smart-looking text-to-map strategy war shoot-em-up, have really given the format a boost. Most exciting of all, it's a top-secret news that by December, the 3DO will have a brand-new add-on cartridge, codenamed M2. These pictures are from the graphic demo disc of a new racing game that could be released as early as this year. 3DO claimed that M2 will be up to 10 times more powerful than any other console currently available around the world. But we'll just have to wait and see.
If you're looking to buy a new console, then our advice is all the hardware's pretty clever, so
look at the software available and choose whichever machine's got the best selection of games for you.
Now it's time for a brand new feature here on Bad Influence. Every week, our games expert Violet Berlin will present some of her personal views in Virtual Violet.
Gamers are about to be overwhelmed by a slew of sequels. Classic games currently being warmed up and worked over include Magic Carpet, Street Fighter, Superstar Soccer. So, is it worth shelling out for new versions of old games, or are we being ripped off with overheated leftovers? To help you out, I've chosen a few of the most promising. FIFA Soccer 96. One better than 95? Well, everything's new and improved, of course, and they finally got round to including real club teams. But the best new player has got to be...
And he shoots! They're back in the game!
John Motson, commentating live on the PC CD version.
Ah, quite remarkable!
On the SNES, there's Donkey Kong Country 2. Donkey Kong has disappeared, so in his place, meet Dixie Kong. She's a girl well, monkey, with a killer hairdo. More old faces. Fade to Black, the sequel to the classic Flashback, should provide those who haven't had their memory erased with a happy sense of deja vu. Hero Conrad Hart is back, and no doubt totally disorientated to find himself in a 3D environment for the first time. And finally, there's a sequel to a sequel. Mortal Kombat 3. Nasty characters, new and old, more gore, endless unpleasant special moves, and a collection of animalities, babalities, and fatalities that would churn the stomach of a psycho. In fact, I feel ill just thinking about it.
Violet Berlin, Lost in Cyberspace, and look out for reviews of those games later on in the series. This week's main review is Panzer Dragoon on the Saturn. It's being touted as a future of shoot-em-up games on the next generation machines. You sit astride a huge dragon as you shoot your way through 3D levels. You can view the game either from on top of the dragon or from behind, so you can see the whole of the winged beast in front of you. And an important part of the gameplay is rotating your view through 360 degrees, so you can fight off attacks from any angle. Has a shoot-em-up ever looked this good? Probably not, but does it play as good as it looks? Here's Sahail.
When you start playing this game, you think it's going to be something spectacular, but after you've played it for a while, you realize how limited the gameplay is. The main emphasis of the game is just shooting, and after a while it gets really boring. You've got three viewpoints in the game, one on the back of the dragon, one further out, and one further out still. You can also look round 360 degrees, which is the only good thing about the game, as it lets you see the enemies that are approaching. However, one gripe I've got is that the controls are far too sensitive. It's too easy to oversteer going left or right. Another gripe I've got is that the gameplay is limited. You can only go left or slightly right. You can't divert from the set path that the game puts you on. I think it's the best game out on the Saturn at the moment, but at this price, I'd save my money for something a little more playable.
It's difficult to see the enemies because they blend into the background and the levels don't vary enough, but the gameplay is quite addictive.
I felt sick when I played this. The flowing graphics don't make up for the lack of gameplay.
And the scores for Panzer Dragoon. Both the girls and the boys gave it a never mind the graphics, feel the gameplay, 3 out of 5.
Next! Stop, stop, stop!
Get your motor.
Thank you.
Oh well, if like me, your musical talent is best used on a pair of maracas, come this way because we've found the very thing. If like me, you're a wannabe rock star. Want to find out if the fantasy is anything like reality? We just happen to have our own friendly rock star wandering around the studio.
Rock
star and actor and general nice guy, Craig McLachlan, is here with us. And he's playing a tune for us. As you can hear, Craig is sounding considerably better than I did. Now, this is for two reasons. A, it's because Craig is more talented musically than I am. But also because he's using this, which is the virtual guitar. It's got real strings, but it's not the vibration of the strings that makes the noise, like on a real guitar. When Craig strikes the strings, it sends a message to the computer, and then the computer software tells the computer to play the right notes. But you do get to control the strings.
You do indeed.
And you're having a lot of fun with it, aren't you?
I am. This thing is wild.
So how does it compare to like playing a real Gibson Les Paul like this?
Well, it's kind of different because obviously as a guitar player, you have control of the guitar. You're kind of working in tandem with the computer here. But at least you've got, basically you've got this green line with peaks on it, and there's a red line that kind of cruises along that green line with the peaks, and it's giving you a clear indication of when to strike the strings, but still.
So if you're like me and you ain't got no rhythm, then you just follow along like
you
that.
You just follow that red line, yeah. It's kind of crazy. I mean, for people who aren't necessarily into learning an instrument but are right into computer games, here we go, look, power chord section. Excellent, again. Ah, look at us. I feel a new band coming
yeah,
on.
Check 3-4.
Check 5-6.
You sounded brilliant. There is some other software for virtual guitar coming out soon, but at the moment, the only other available CD is called Quest for Fame, and it features the aging American rock stars Aerosmith. You start on the road to rock stardom by putting in the practice in your bedroom. If you've got talent, then you get to join a local band and play a few gigs at the CD Roadkill Grill, the hangout of a group of less than friendly purple bikers.
That's not Steppenwolf.
Alternatively, you can jam with the Ace Men at Snooki's Juke Joint. Of course, if you can't cut it, then you get a little hint on alternative careers.
Structural Safety Inspector.
If you stick with it and make the grade, then you get the chance to cut a few tracks with Aerosmith in the recording studio and then go all the way to the Humonga Dome and play on stage with Aerosmith in front of thousands of screaming fans. The virtual guitar will be available for Christmas, but Craig's new single, which is called
If We Were Angels,
will be released
In a couple of weeks' time.
And does not feature the virtual guitar at all.
Fortunately.
Mercifully. Right, time for some smoking rock and roll.
Yeah, we're
on. Two, three, four!
While Andy practices to be a superstar, earlier this year, Violet went to Laguna Beach in California to meet a real superstar of the computer games world. Dave Perry is the hit programmer behind big games like Aladdin and Earthworm Jim. And this year, he and his team have been creating Earthworm Jim 2.
And here he is, the great man himself, clearly deep in thought. Now, we've arranged to interview Dave about his new game, Earthworm Jim 2, which he's almost certainly thinking about at this very moment.
I'd just like to thank the Academy for this honor. I'd like to thank my mom, my dad, my art teacher. This is a very proud moment for all of us. The Brits are coming!
Well, clearly Dave is lost in his creative thought processes. So, while we're waiting, let's have a look at how Earthworm Jim 2 is coming along.
Bursting onto the screen this Christmas, the worm is back. The sequel is packed with new features and crazy creatures, with pig shoots and granny movers, just two of the devious new perils that the worm has to slither past. Everyone has their favourite level, but apart from the unicycling maggots, what tickles Dave's fancy?
Dave? Dave who?
This idea of Dave's is going to be just amazing. This whole area is just buzzing.
On a huge project like Earthworm Jim 2, there are dozens of different elements that gel together for the finished game. Traditional artists, software programmers and animators all have to come up with great ideas and make them work, beginning with graphic designers like Steve.
When we came up with the concept, I decided I wanted to see it all in 3D and get as good a 3D look as we possibly could. And the programmers just said, basically, forget it, this can't be done. But I kept on pestering them, and finally they've come up with something that's much better than I thought we'd be able to do, as you can see.
The programmers split the play area into strips from the top of the screen to the bottom. Then they let the strips scroll across the screen separately at different speeds, which gives the illusion of depth and a 3D feel.
What we found on Jim 2 is that we've really pushed the machines now to their final limit. We believe this is as far as they can go.
An even bigger headache was the soil level. Here, Jim can choose to go anywhere on screen by digging through the soil with a dentist's drill. The computer has to make thousands of calculations a second to work out where the soil is falling from, where it will land, and then what shape it will form for Jim to walk on. A real mathematician's nightmare.
My first reaction, you can't do that, but they persuaded me to give it a little bit harder try.
Presumably, if he hadn't solved the problem, Dave would have taken out his other arm.
Dave? Dave who?
Any minute now. Well, you can't hurry these things. The original Earthworm Jim had a very distinctive look because it used a new animation technique.
This technique made Jim move incredibly smoothly. But for Earthworm Jim 2, the animators wanted him to look even sexier.
We continued to use the paper animation like we always had, but we drew a separate shadow layer onto the paper and then put that on top of these images. And when we put the two together, we get this image here with the shadow on top of the drawing, and it gives it a little bit more dimension. And the shadows actually animate with the drawings.
Nice work, but not as sexy as Dave, eh?
Dave? Dave who?
Well, if he wasn't so busy now working on his great ideas, I'd obviously now be thanking Dave for being with us. Still, I'll always treasure the memories of being in the presence of the great man at work. Thanks, Dave.
Nice work if you can get it. Earthworm Jim 2 will be out in December.
But now it's time for this week's news and previews.
And more news about the M2 cartridge for the 3DO that we mentioned earlier. Apart from the racing game, there are two other games under development. This one, a Doom-style shoot-em-up and a brilliantly animated beat-em-up. There are only two characters in the demo at the moment, a fighting fit female and a vicious velociraptor.
You may have seen on TV recently footage that purports to be an autopsy of an alien life form. Well, if you want to judge for yourself if it's genuine or just a special effects mock-up, this CD contains the full 20-minute silent black-and-white film showing the alien being taken apart piece by piece. Not for the squeamish or the gullible.
You've seen the film, you've read the bank balance. Now play the game. Waterworld, the most expensive film in history, is soon to be a game on the SNES and Mega Drive. The game is made up of three different types of gameplay. There's a 3D shoot-em-up where you have to escape from the evil smokers, and two sorts of platform, one on dry land and one based deep beneath the sea.
And now for some more games reviews. Holy mackerel, the Bat is back in his biggest adventure yet, Batman Forever on the SNES. The caped crusader is still stalking Gotham City, but this time not content with taking on one supervillain, he's matching fists with the whole darn lot of them. The Winged Wonder can punch, kick and blast his way past enemies, Two-Face and Riddler, solving puzzles, executing super moves and picking up a fine array of technical gadgetry. Over to Aisha.
This is another typical platform game released on the back of a blockbuster. It could have been a lot better. This is level 3 at the circus. Batman's got to find the bomb and defuse it, so he's racing against the clock. I found the graphics very monotonous and it's difficult to figure out where to go and there's no indication of what to do. Although, like most platform games these days, there's a lot of hidden levels. The major flaw in the game is that it stops every time you go to a new area. You'd expect that on a CD, but not on a cartridge. It's really tedious waiting for the next bit to load. Nowadays, you expect good graphics, but this is an old-fashioned and frustrating game to play.
A few elements of this game fail to impress. It's a bit slow and a little dark, but overall, it keeps you hooked.
It plays great, but you spend too much time waiting for levels to load.
And the scores for Batman Forever, not good, I'm afraid. The boys gave it 2 out of 5, and the girls 3 out of 5.
This is Primal Rage, a prehistoric beat-em-up with a difference. The monsters have the usual range of gruesome special effects and fatalities, and the game is coming out on a range of formats, including Game Boy, Game Gear, SNES, and Mega Drive. But does it have what it takes? Over to Chris with the Mega Drive version.
Primal Rage is yet another beat-em-up, but instead of the more usual human-like characters, you play with vicious prehistoric mutants. The animation is fluid, and a lot of work has clearly gone into the graphics. But the whole game is very dated, the characters are limited, and to be quite honest, we've seen a lot of games on the market that do this kind of thing better. I'm playing Talent here, I've just done a Face Ripper, which has beaten Chaos. Anyone who has played the coin-op will have a hard time adjusting to the joypad controls. It isn't really suited to a home conversion.
It's an outdated style of game. The graphics are tacky. It's a waste of time, energy and money, and I'm definitely not impressed.
It's slow and it doesn't compare to any of the recent fighting games. The characters merge in with the background too much and I became bored too quickly to find out any of the special moves.
Scores then? Well, the boys gave it a sad 2 out of 5 and the girls an even lower 1 out of 5.
That's just about it for this week. Just time to fit in our competition. We're giving away a Sega Saturn with Panzer Dragoon. And the question is, what was the original meaning of the word dragoon? Was it A, a soldier, B, an insect, or C, a mythical beast? If you think you know, call us on 0891 800 300. 0891 800 300. The call will cost you no more than 25p. The lines will stay open until midnight on Sunday, but do please get permission from whoever pays the phone bill before you dial. Remember, we always check if you have done.
That's right, guys. You can't win. You haven't asked for permission.
Right, time to go. Go on, off you go.
Aww.
Off you go.
Come on.
Go on. That really is it for this week. So it's goodbye from me and take it away, Andy and Craig. As far away as possible, preferably.
Side of the bed, and how I got to thinking about all those things you said.